Yeah, welcome back to our Economics of Innovation course. Last week we discussed adoption and diffusion of new technology, and I think I started with this Schumpeterian quote, and the main point in a sense was that that the economic logic might be quite different from the technological logic, and the economic logic might prevail. That is, we see all people using old technology, but that's just due to the fact that it's more profitable or beneficial, okay? And I think last week I then, after some giving you some empirical introduction, I started to present the so-called epidemic approach to you. And I think I just can jump back to the Mansfield model, which just showed you how to derive this parameter, this infection parameter of the epidemic approach, or how to relate that to economic parameters or variables, just like profitability and cost. And the very important point here was this uncertainty. And the argument was that if you meet someone who uses this new technology, that means that the uncertainty about this technology is somehow reduced and you might get infected. That is, you might choose to adopt this new technology. Of course, this is a rather passive and indirect approach. There is not much modeling of the act of adoption or of information acquisition. I now want you to show or to present a paper by Richard Jensen, published in the Journal of Economic Theory in 1982. And this is, in a sense, much more explicit. It's a decision theoretic approach. That means someone is optimizing, and adoption or to adopt is a decision under uncertainty. And here information increases over time, but it's in a sense in a much more obvious way. It's not such a like an infection, but these agents do something, okay? It's a more explicit modeling of information acquisition. And the point is that firms, and that's what we are talking about, it might also be customers, but here our main interest lies in firms, they adopt once they are sufficiently confident that the new technology is a success. And as always, or very often, the new technology has uncertain profitability. And as always, we want to make life easy, and we have only two possible outcomes. Either it has a high outcome, it is profitable, or it has a low outcome. And the interesting thing is now that a good innovation has a high probability of a high profit, and a bad has a low one. Just think about, should you adopt the next generation of, say, Windows, okay? You have been using XP for years, and now they come up with this Windows 7 or 8, should you use it? You don't know whether it's really a good innovation or not so good, and the point is here how it works. You have people around you, which you might ask whether they have introduced this innovation. And you meet someone, and this guy then tells you, okay, it's a great innovation. The point is, from this information, you know that someone got a positive signal, as we call it. But the point is that this might be a nerd or something like that, and for him, it's good, even though it's a bad innovation, and others might send you a bad signal telling that that's a bad one. So the point is, why do we need this strange kind specification or modeling? The point is, otherwise the problem would be trivial if one signal would be sufficient to know that it's a good innovation. We would only need one person to talk to, and we would know that either we adopt it or not, okay? But that's not how real life is, because typically experiences with a new technology are different, and so you cannot immediately tell from asking to one user of such a technology whether it's good or bad. So now, moving on with the model, our probability that it's a high innovation or that the probability that you get a high outcome, that is a high profit, is G or B. With a good innovation, it's G, say 75% that you get a high profit. With a bad innovation, it might be just 25% with that you get a high profit. You have some adoption costs, C, and the difference, or the most important difference, is that you might want, or that to adopt a good innovation is profitable, to adopt a bad innovation is not profitable. What does it mean? Now, with a good innovation, you get a high profit with a probability G, and of course, the low profit then with the converse probability 1 minus G. And the assumption is that this is higher than the cost of adoption. So if you have a 75% to get a high profit and a 25% to get a low profit, it's quite likely that you can cover the cost. But if B is, for instance, only 25% with a bad innovation, you only get the high profit with a 25% chance and the low profit with the 75% chance, so the low operating profit, we would have to say, and this is probably not likely to cover the adoption cost. So this is a setup of our problem. Everyone knows these probabilities, but of course they do not know how likely it is that you get a certain or whether it's a good or bad innovation, and that's what we turn to next. Hopefully it was clear with my example. If not, just ask then in the chat. Okay, the starting point, how does information acquisition look like? The idea is that you wait until you meet someone, and you meet someone every time you go to the city, and you receive then a costless signal. So this person, this agent, tells you whether he or she adopted, and then whether it turned out to be a nice technology or not. Okay. So you meet your fellow students, they tell you if they used Windows, say, 7 or 8, we tell you whether it works well for them or not. And so this is a delay because you have to wait until you need the next. And you need a signal which tells you either it's high or it's a good thing, probability of a high profit, or it's a bad thing, probability of a low profit. And here, the probability that you receive this signal 1, that it's high, is just the probability that you get a high profit. Okay? Now, what is the probability that you get a high profit? You only can determine that if you have some belief about how likely it is that this new Windows version is a good or a bad innovation. Just suppose it's 50%, then your estimated probability that the innovation is profitable, or differently and better, the probability that the innovation gives you a high profit is just this Q here. What does this mean? Now, if you don't have any idea what whether Windows 7 or 10 is a good innovation, you might just assign some number. If you don't have any idea, you might say it's 50%. If you're a Microsoft hater, you might say it was always bad, so it's only 5%. And if you love Microsoft, you might say it's 90%. Okay? So you might have some so-called prior belief. And now if you have this 50% chance, that's just the example I gave you here. Suppose you believe that it's a good innovation is 50%, of course then you also get 50% that it's a bad innovation, then the estimated profit, the probability that the profit is high is just 1/2 times. With a good innovation, you have a probability that you get a high profit of 3/4. With a bad innovation, you have a probability of getting positive probability that you get a good result, that you get a high innovation, that this technology works for you, but it's only 1/4. And here simply you would say then it's just 1/2 this probability. Okay, so that's the point, is we have some subjective element here, which is this P, this initial belief. You have some belief, or you have to have some belief about this technology, whether it's a good one or it's a bad one. Okay, we we are rather silent on why they are different, but we just assume that people just have some belief. And here, if this belief is higher, for instance, then of course the probability that you expect the innovation to be profitable, or that the profit is high, would now no longer be 1/2, but it would be 5/8. Okay, we will all do that, or we will have a nice example on that in the tutorial class. Okay, so hopefully the basic idea is clear, because now we are playing around with many kinds of Bayesian updating and look how your information evolves over time. Okay, because the point is you might have a certain threshold, we will derive that later, you might want to have a certain level of security or certainty that it's a good innovation, and you can, or where it's a bad innovation, and you can get additional certainty by waiting a period, because then you will leave another fellow student, and he or she tells you then whether this innovation is a good thing. So you receive another signal if you wait. Now the question is, how do you update your beliefs? Okay, you start with some initial probability, we had 1/2 or 3/4, and then you update that. Now, how do you update the probability that the innovation is good if the signal is positive? Okay, that's what we are doing, and now what we are doing is actually Bayesian updating. And you will see that the belief that the innovation is good if you receive a positive signal is just this function h1 of p, where we have this expression here, and I just want to explain that in more detail here with this reference to conditional probability. You should know that, because this is simply Bayes' law, the probability or the conditional probability of event A given event B is just, oh, I think it's the union, the probability of the union A and or the intersection. Oh, that's a good thing here, of A and B divided by PB. So what does this mean in terms of our model here? And this is much easier. You have the probability that you have a good innovation, okay, with the G, if the signal is positive. Now, this is just this here, okay? The probability of a good innovation given the signal is positive. This is just the probability that you have and this is what we know from Bayes' law here, okay? That we have a good innovation and at the same time receive a positive signal, which signals that it's a good innovation. So this person had a high profit, divided by the probability that we receive this good signal. Okay? And now, we can just rearrange it because the probability that it's a good signal is just here. That would have been a further step here. This is just the probability that you receive a high signal given that it's a good innovation times the probability that's a good innovation. Okay, divided by P1. And now here on the next line, I just explain to you how we derive these probabilities. The point is, what is the probability that you receive a high profit given that you have a good innovation? Yeah, this was just a probability G. Remember, on the previous slide, we assumed that with a good innovation with a probability 75%, you get a high profit. So and therefore you get this signal that you have a high profit with the 75% chance. So this is this. The probability that you have a good innovation is just the belief we started with. Okay, this 50%. Windows 10 is a good innovation with 50% chance, or that's just some subjective probability. And finally, what is the probability that you receive a good signal? Now, yeah, this is just you receive a good signal if the respective agent had a high profit, but the probability that it had a high profit was just what we derived on the previous a page with, oh, and I was too quick again, with this, which is Q here, okay? The probability that you have a high a profit, okay? That's this Q. And given we have these probabilities, we can immediately, and now I have to erase all my drawings here again. If we have this probability, we can immediately determine the updated belief, and therefore we get a new probability in the next period where the innovation is good. Given the signal is positive, of course, we can also get another signal, namely that it's negative, that the respective agent had made losses or had a low profit, okay? And how does that look like? Again, here, the belief or the probability that it's a good innovation, given that the signal was bad. So the important point is here, even if you receive a bad signal, the new technology might be actually a good one, okay? This was just by coincidence, it just didn't work for some reasons. Oh, I just read that the recent upgrade update of Windows 10 caused some problems for people who had some kind of outdated drivers, okay? Of course, if you meet some of these guys, he or she will tell you, this update is really bad, don't do it, but it was only specific to that person because they had installed some legacy driver which just doesn't work with the new version, and for 95% of all other Windows users, there's no problem with the update and they gain from that, okay? So just to make this point clear. And now, what do we get here? Again, we get this H function, just H here of 0, that is, if you receive a bad signal. And again here, the P here is just the probability, again here, from down here, where it's a good innovation. The 1 minus G is just the probability, that's what we have here, is just this would be just this 1 minus G here would be just the probability, the conditional probability that you receive a bad signal even though it's a good innovation, and that would be just equal to 1 minus G, and the 1 minus Q is just the probability that you receive a low profit. Hopefully this is clear. In the notes I gave you some further examples. For instance, in this case where I assume that your initial belief is 3/4 and you get a good signal, then you can immediately calculate that the belief, given that you or that the updated belief, given that you get a good signal, is 90%. And if you get a bad signal, you discount that belief and you get only a 50% chance. Again, this should become much clearer once you calculate the examples in the assignment. Okay, so now we are almost done. The point is here, we want to determine how much or how many people you should ask whether to upgrade or update your Windows 10 version, okay? And here we start with some initial belief, P0. We have N observations, that is, we ask N people who have updated or who have the new version, and K of these people give you a favorable answer. That means they tell you, do this update, it's great. Okay, and then what you get here, the probability that it's a good innovation is just then a function of N, the number of observations of K and of P0. You might probably know that from your stochastics course in school. I don't expect you to calculate or to derive this somehow binomial expression here. It's ugly, but that's what it gives you, okay? And I think I just want to show you, I think in Mathematica, how that looks like, because you should get some idea. I don't know how well you how well developed your räumliches Vorstellungsvermögen is, your spatial perception, but what I depicted here and I hope you can see that on a YouTube stream, is just the probability. I think here you see it better. It's a probability. It's some probability, of course, is something between 0 and 1. And here we have the ends and the k's. The n's is the number of observations, the k's is the number of favorable, of good observations, and of course we cannot have a higher number of k than of n. That's why it's cut here at the 45 degrees line. And what you see here in this, turn it around, I hope you see it better this way. We start here with a prior belief of 0.7, so this is about here, it's 70% here, and now suppose you have 20 observations. If 5 of these 20 observations are positive, then you are almost at zero probability, because that means that 15 are negative, and you assign a very low probability that it's a good innovation. If then on the other side 15 observations or signals are favorable, you assign a rather high probability. And what you see here is it is probably sufficient to have only a few observations to already get an idea, because you know if it's really a good innovation, you should get which has, say, only a 25% chance of giving a bad outcome, you should get a rather high number of favorable signals. And so you will rather soon learn how whether this is a good innovation. This is slightly different here. I assume that the difference between a good and a bad on an innovation in terms of probability is rather small, 45 and 55%. And here you see you don't get these like a cliff here. It's almost like, I don't know how you, cliffs of Dover or something like that. And here you see it's much smoother. So you will have to take many more or will have to go for many more observations in order to get a clear picture of how well this innovation works. Okay? So, given we know somehow how this updating now works, we can, of course, solve our optimization problem, our optimal adoption problem. And in order to do that, we write up or we write down here the value of this new technology as a function of the probability, as a function of the updated belief. This is the value of the firm as a function of the updated belief, and that's a max of VA of adopting and of VW, which is of waiting. So, and I define that in the next two lines. What does this mean? If I adopt right now, what is my expected profit? Now, in this point of time, given my prior, I can estimate the probability with which I get a high profit, and of course with the converse probability I get a low profit. And of course my profit is then a C. Of course, and then the alternative is not investing, not adopting now, but waiting one period longer for the next signal. Of course, if I wait, I have to discount my future gains, because I don't get any gain today, and beta is just a discount factor here. And then in the next period, I receive a signal which is positive with a certain probability. Namely, this is just a probability that it's a high profit. And if it's a high profit, if this respective agent has a high profit with this probability, I will receive a signal high, and that's why we have this function with the one here. So you have then the value with the update, with the updated belief, and with the converse probability 1 minus q, you receive the bad signal, and then your value will be this here. So this is an optimal stopping problem, which has been this is in formal terms quite complicated to solve, but the result which Richard Jensen shows in his paper is that there is this turned around. E is just, it means it exists. There exists a P star, a threshold value for the probability such that that VA, the value from adopting, the firm value of adopting is higher than the value of waiting for all P's, greater or equal than P star. So if you end up at some P which is greater than P star, suppose P star is 70%, everyone who has a belief larger than 70% will adopt immediately. Okay? And yeah, does that make sense? I just want to give you just some sketch of the proof. So because if you have a prior belief of zero, you will not adopt right now. Okay? If you have a prior belief of one, you will certainly adopt right now, because by definition, it's a good innovation then, and a good innovation is profitable. And therefore, you know, for very low probabilities, you wait. For very high probabilities, you adopt immediately. And by continuity, you know that some of these thresholds exist, that given you are at, you have some P star, which is even unique if you have some convexity assumptions, and then you will get this threshold value from which on, or which determines whether you adopt or not. Okay? And the nice thing here is, first of all, we now know that there is this threshold, and the point is that the uniform, if you have a uniform distribution of prior beliefs, so just uniformly distributed between 0 and 1. So you have very different users of Microsoft Windows, and some people will assign a low probability, others a slightly higher, and others like me, I always think Microsoft is good. So so these are different probabilities, and if you have this uniform distribution of prior beliefs, you get either a concave or a S-shaped diffusion curve. So first of all, if you have heterogeneity, you get different adoption dates, and they might even, and that's where theoreticians are always very happy if they can reproduce this S-shaped curve. So they might even produce this pattern. Okay? And finally, what is really interesting here, a good innovation will eventually be adopted just by the law of large numbers. If it's good, at some point in time, you got a sufficient number of good signals, so you will adopt, you will cross any threshold, even though you start up with a prior belief of zero, okay? Even if you're very wary of Microsoft, you will learn then, if it's really a good innovation, that it's a good thing to use Microsoft Teams, for instance. It might also be Apple, okay? If you don't like Apple, you might nevertheless learn at some time that the iPhone is a good thing. If you don't like Samsung, so I think the idea should come through. The very interesting point is that a bad one, so people, even though it's a bad innovation, if you're very optimistic in the very beginning, you might nevertheless adopt it, because even though it's bad, okay? So if you're an Apple addict, you will adopt the next iPhone 25 anyway, irrespective of whether it's a good innovation or not. And even if it turns out to be a bad one, as you're over-optimistic, you will adopt it. Okay, I think that's pretty much what I wanted to tell you on Richard Jensen's model here. Perhaps talking of extension. So first of all, of course, what you see here is that these prior beliefs are really important. They drive the diffusion curve, even though they might, in a sense, delay innovation or adoption and diffusion and so on. And this is a rather subjective thing. And you see here again, what we might call expectation management is really, really important. So what we do not consider here in this model is some costs of gathering information. A firm might have to visit trade fairs and so on to in order to get this innovation. For you, it's rather simple because, unless we have a corona crisis and we don't have, and you don't meet your fellow students in the cafeteria, but apart from that, you should be able to gather information. What is a shortcoming here is that there is no strategic interaction. Okay, these are all pretty much monopolists. Okay, and now, this is the other point here, which I now introduce the cost of the adoption is just some given constant number C. Okay, and you will see in a minute that very often the costs look quite different. They look like this here. Okay, the problem is when is the optimal time to buy a computer? Actually, usually the optimal time is never, because if you wait, you get the computer cheaper. Okay, of course that's bad, because you cannot use a new computer then. You have to stick with your old one. And we want to, in the next part, we want to show, or to, I want to present to you another decision theoretic approach, where we take into account this shape of the adoption cost function, okay, which you know from computers, from many other things, where we explicitly derive the adoption decision of an individual firm from profit maximizing behavior. We did that in a previous case as well, but here we take into account that adoption costs might decrease over time. Okay. Before I move on, I make a short break here in case you have any questions concerning the previous approach from Richard Jensen. Yeah, moving on with our decision theoretic approach. Perfect information about the adoption cost is at a sensible assumption. If you look, for instance, at the evolution of the costs of photovoltaic panel, in the very beginning it was not clear how we will evolve, but once you are say in 95 or so, you see that it's pretty much going down. And what you really see is just what we had on a previous page, this downward sloping thing. And if I were to manage to put that all, perhaps someone of you could do that, to put that all in one diagram, you would see that the shape would be just something like this here. That's what we see in the previous slide, that adoption costs are decreasing over time, but at a decreasing rate. Okay, now we are going to the question, when should you buy your computer? When should you adopt a new computer? And that's what we are doing right now. We start with the adoption decision of a single firm. And again, this single firm now has to take into account this decreasing adoption cost. Okay, and how does that look like? And we start with a setup, with a situation in which we might have potentially heterogeneous agents. This situation was called by Kashenas and Stoneman rank effects model. I will explain later on why we have that. So we have some expected returns from adoption. That's what we previously had as well. And firms might be different or might be heterogeneous because they are of different size. They have different R&D expenditures. They have different market shares. And now what we have to do is we have to determine the optimal adoption date of a single firm. And therefore, we just set up this wonderful, nice present discounted value capital pi. T here is our adoption date we choose. Okay, and we maximize this integral over just by choosing our adoption date. Now, what is written here? First of all, we have to explain, or I have to explain to you the notation here. Pi, of course, is the per period or the profit stream, the per period profit or the profit stream, and pi zero is just the profit stream you have once you have not yet adopted a new technology. Pi one is the profit stream you earn once you have adopted a new technology. Okay, in the first instance, you have a profit with your old technology, and pi one is the profit you have once you introduce this assembly line with robots or something like that. And now it's clear, again, we put that in continuous time. That's why we have not 1 over 1 plus r as discounting, but here these exponential terms. That's what you already should be familiar here. R is our interest or discount rate. From 0 up to your adoption date, capital T, you, of course, earn the profit without innovation. At time T, you adopt, and from this point on, you get the higher profit stream, okay? And of course, you have to pay the adoption costs which accrue once you choose adoption date of T. Say, remember our solar panel costs. If you adopt in 2005, you have to pay the adoption costs relevant in this year. And now what you do, once you have these nice integrals, you just simplify them. These are all actually straightforward here, because it goes to infinity. You know, if you have a profit stream until infinity, you just divide by r. It's just like pi zero. If you were never to adopt, you would just get pi zero all of the time, and you just divide it by r in order to get the value of this infinite series. But if you adopt at some time t, of course, from this time on, you get an increase in the profit stream. And of course, this increase also holds on for all future times. But of course, it starts only in t, and that's why you have to discount it to time zero, and you have to pay that that adoption cost. Okay? Should be clear, hopefully. Yeah, it's just how you set up present discounted value function pi here in continuous time. Now, we are interested, of course, in the optimal date of adoption. Optimal date of adoption. But what does that mean? Now, yeah, we just have to take the derivative. We have to take the derivative with respect to the adoption date capital T. So we just take the derivative with respect to T. And this is actually straightforward because we have T up here. If we take the derivative there, we just get minus R. Okay. Actually, as it's in the numerator as well, we just can cancel it out. So we get only the minus. And of course, we are left with the minus RT here. Oh, it should be a capital T. Times pi 1 minus pi 0 minus x prime of t, the derivative with respect to 0, and that's supposed to be 0. The derivative with respect to t, of course. I don't know whether you can well recognize that, but hopefully x prime of t, of course x prime of t is nothing else than dx dt. Okay? And I probably just should erase that in order to not make it unclear. So this is the first order condition. Okay, and I just reproduce that on the next page, so it's easier for you. And I just put this term on the other side, because here I got the minus loss. But now we have a nice interpretation, and this already solves your problem when to buy a new computer. On the left hand side, you have the gain from adopting marginally earlier. What is the gain? You now have the better computer. This is just your profit increase, okay, if you adopt that T. What is the cost? Now, yeah, if you adopt earlier, this is positive here, your adoption costs increase. Okay, perhaps I could jump back to this slide here. If you adopt here, the slope, if you wait a little bit, if you adopt rather late, you don't gain much by waiting, okay, because costs go down only a little. If you're, however, deciding that you want next year to buy one, the derivative is much steeper, and you would gain a lot by waiting, okay. And you see somewhere you just have these E minus RT. Actually, this would also be discounted, that's why it's more complicated, but here you would get pi 1 minus pi 0. Okay, you will see in a minute why it looks different. I have a graphical description of that later on. Okay, so now it should be clear. Now we explained this first order condition. Hopefully you now know when to buy your next computer, what are the trade-offs. And obviously it's clear if you have different firms, where the different firms have different gains from adoption, they will adopt at different dates. This is just, they will choose different slopes of the adoption cost function. And so ex ante heterogeneity leads to different gains from adoption and therefore different adoption dates. Okay? So that is the so-called rank effects model. And it explains in such a decision theoretic model from, in a sense, first principles from profit maximization, why different firms adopt at different dates. The problem or two elements of the previous approach are not completely satisfactory. First of all, competition doesn't matter. It does not exist in this model. You only have, in a sense, monopolists. Think of just what happens to Opel if Volkswagen and if all other car manufacturers produce a new technology in their assembly lines, like robots. If they are able to reduce their cost by adopting a new technology, typically that should adversely affect the profit of its rivals. Okay, and so it would always be good to also account for competition, and that's in a so-called stock effects models. And second of all, of course, it's interesting we have diffusion, but it requires heterogeneous firms. For a theoretician, it would always be interesting whether you could also come up with a model where even among ex-ante identical firms, you get sequential adoption, that is diffusion, okay? And that's what I'm going to present you now. It actually goes back to work by Jennifer Ringanum, published in the early 80s. And she shows that if the gains from adoption depend on the stock of firms already using a new technology, you will get diffusion. And you will have to suffer with a little bit more here on this topic because I spent half of my time on my PhD dissertation on these topics. Okay, stock effects with Cournot competition here. It's pretty much very similar to what we previously had. That's why I can move on, I think, here rather quickly. First of all, we do it simply in the first article. Jennifer Ringanum just assumed that we have a duopoly, and these duopolies decide today at which time they want to have a new technology available. So just think of if you're a company which thinks about introducing some SAP system, you cannot then decide, okay, I want to have it tomorrow, but you have an implementation process, and you will pretty much have a similar function. Like, again, I always jump back to this function. Oh, that was definitely the wrong one here. I wanted to show you this slide here. And so today you're deciding on, today at t equal to zero, you're deciding whether you want to have it available after 3 years or after 4 years. And the point is, if you only want to take 3 years to implement such a complicated system, it will lead to higher costs than if you want to have it available after 4 years. That's what we also have with COVID-19. If you want to have some vaccine, and if you want to have it soon, we have to spend much more money in discounted terms, in present value terms, than if we take more time. Okay, and we make an important assumption on the payoffs here, and the payoffs just mean, again, the notation here. I'm firm one, I'm this firm, and pi 1, the subscript here, denotes that I have used a new technology. If my subscript is 0, I don't use a new technology. I use the old technology. The superscript denotes what my rival does or what my rival's technology is. So pi 1, 0 means that here I use a new technology, but my rival still uses the old technology. And now what this tells us is if I'm the first adopter, my profit gain, my increase in profits is higher than if I'm the second adopter.
Okay, second adopter here, because here my rival already uses the new technology. That's an important assumption, and that's an assumption you typically get in Cournot. You also would get it in trivially or almost degenerate way in Bertrand. Okay, because in Bertrand, my profit would always be zero here. In Bertrand, my profit would be zero if my rival has a new technology, but I have the old one. If my rival has a new technology and I have the new technology, we both have the same cost, so our profit would still be zero. If we both have the old technology, my profit would be zero. But if I'm the only one, remember our error model, who has a new technology, lower cost, and my rival has a higher cost, I will have a positive profit. So trivially, it's satisfied here, this assumption. But it's also satisfied under Cournot, and I think we will have a problem in the assignments here. Okay, that's what I told you. So we can even move back to our Cournot part, and we will see that. Okay, that's an important assumption, but which is satisfied for many workhorse models we use here. Yeah, now we are doing the same thing as previously, and now our profit function looks even nicer. So now we set up the discounted profit of a firm as a function of its own adoption date and of its rival adoption date, which is assumed to be T0. And we have to distinguish two different cases. Either I adopt earlier than my rival, or I adopt later. Okay. If I adopt earlier than my rival, if I have not adopted a new technology, I get this profit stream each period where no one of us uses a new technology. At time T, I adopt the new technology, that's the same as here, and my profit jumps up because now I'm the one with the new technology, I'm the adopter, and my rival still has the old technology. But at time T0, my rival, and that's what we have here again, my rival also adopts the new technology, and my profit actually will go down again, okay? Because now my rival has also the new technology. And completely analogous is what happens here if I'm the late adopter. If I'm the late adopter, and that's a bad thing about being a late adopter, until time T0, nothing happens. But at time T0, even though I haven't done anything, having done anything bad, okay? The only point is my profit still goes down, okay? Because now my rival has a lower cost because she has adopted a new technology and at time T0. And that still keeps on being my profit until I start to adopt the new technology, and then I just catch up in a sense, okay? That's what we get. Very similar to our previous numbers, but just slightly a bit more complicated due to the fact that I also have the second firm now to consider. But actually, the first order conditions look very similar, and the simplified conditions also look very similar. And what we will see, or what we will look into, is that there exists two adoption date. One adoption date T early, where you adopt earlier than the rival, and this is derived, or this is the first order condition here. Okay, this is the first order condition here from the first line here, and it's identical to what we previously had. Same condition. The only difference is here now that we have the second firm. And here I'm the early adopter. And note here, and that's why we get T early and T late. I think, do we have T late as well? Yeah, here's for T late. If I'm the late adopter, my rival has adopted earlier. And the point is, this is pretty much the same as what I derived some three slides ago, okay? Same kind of I just have to erase my my circles here, same as we previously had. And the point is, it just gives rise to different adoption dates, okay? T late and too early, and T early. And the point is, our first result would be that T early, of course, is earlier than T late. Otherwise, it wouldn't make sense to use this terminology. But the point, this follows directly from the fact that we have this assumption on how the gain from adoption looks like for the early mover and for the late mover. Okay, that was on the previous slide. This was our assumption that the profit gain for the first adopter is higher than the profit gain for the second adopter. Okay, what we can see, or what actually Jennifer Green-Ganem showed in their paper, was that there exists two pure strategy Nash equilibrium of this game, and these are asymmetric equilibria in the sense that in one equilibrium, firm one chooses an early adoption date and firm two chooses a late adoption date. Okay? Different adoption date for ex ante identical firms. That's a really interesting insight, I think, and that's why she got this paper well published. And of course, we have a second here. We assume that firm one is the early adopter, of course, and firm two the late adopter. Of course, we can also just change roles, and that's the second equilibrium then. So, important result: ex ante identical firms choose different adoption dates. And what, however, is a bit less nice is that these firms have different adoption dates, namely the profit of the early adopter is greater, so you would always want to be the early adopter. Okay, we will get back to that later on in the setup then of a paper by Drew Fudenberg and Shaw Tirol from 1985, where we introduce rent equalization in a slightly different model, but I will get back to that later. Okay, so this is formally rather complicated. Hopefully you got the idea. I just want to show you that in terms of a diagram. I think these diagrams have even been I took these diagrams even from my PhD thesis, so I spent some time on that. So suppose this T0, as we assumed in a previous slide, is the adoption date of the rival. So here is time, and here you see the adoption dates, and here is your present discounted value. If your rival chooses some intermediate value of adoption, the point is you have two local maxima, either the early adoption date or the late adoption date. As it's put here, it's obvious you would choose the early adoption date. Okay? Should be clear. So here, these are uniquely defined by these grid lines here. This is everywhere where you have a flat rate here, or you see that you have a maximum, you have a slope of zero here. Okay? Now the question is, of course, how should an equilibrium look like? If I adopt at time TE, or suppose if my rival adopts at TE, because we have to switch roles here, suppose my rival adopts at TE, I claim just that a symmetric equilibrium where both choose TE does not exist. And what you see here, even though if you approach that that adoption date T0 or TE from the left-hand side, you would get a slope of zero here. But you see here, it's no more differentiable. And if your rival adopts early, it's optimal for you to adopt late. Okay? And in a third diagram, we just see if you adopt late, it's optimal for your rival to adopt early. That's what you see here. Okay? That's what you see. And the point is, why don't you just also adopt early if your rival adopts early? Now, the problem is adopting early implies very high adoption cost. But if both firms, if already one firm adopts early, your profit gain will be rather low. Okay? because you just don't earn profits very high. You don't earn the, so to say, monopoly profits or the leader profits, but you both have the profit if both have adopted. So if someone else already has adopted at the early date, it's not worthwhile to adopt to incur the very high adoption costs you have if you adopt very early. So it's better to wait. What I mentioned previously, I told you that what is not so nice about this model is that the early adopter has higher profit than the late adopter. That's what you see here. The profit of the early adopter is more than 12.2. The profit of the late adopter is only 11.2. So it's always better to be an early adopter than the late adopter. Okay? Hopefully you got that, and in particular you got the point that symmetric equilibrium does not exist. Actually, it took me a long time to understand that when I did my PhD thesis in 1992 or something like that, really some time ago. Okay, before I move on with my own model, which grew out of my PhD research and was published several years later, I want to have another short break here. Okay, now I bother you with some of my own research, which was published in the Rand Journal of Economics in 1999. It's actually, in a sense, an application of the Ring-Ganim setup to a monopolistically competitive industry. What is a monopolistically competitive industry? It's an industry where you have many, many firms, actually a continuum of firms, and each firm is a monopolist. You know that due to the production of a differentiated product, but by entering firms, profit are driven down to the zero profit equilibrium. So the starting point of this model here is just a cost reduction. So our firms can adopt the new technology, which reduces their marginal cost from C upper bar to C hat. And of course, C upper bar is higher than C hat. And we come up with some consumers which have an intertemporal utility function. As you previously saw, adoption of a new technology is a dynamic problem, and that's what we have here. Hopefully, it should be somehow familiar from you from your macroeconomics class. Okay, and this is just intertemporal utility function where you have some consumption index C, and here the lock just guarantees that you have constant expenditure each period. And I think I introduced earlier this Dixit-Stiglitz consumption index, which is just an index for differentiated products. The interesting thing is that this gives a wonderful, very easy demand function for each variety. You might wonder why I call it easy, given that it has this integral here in the denominator capturing the effect of the price of all your rivals. The point is that this is a so-called isoelastic demand function, where the elasticity demand depends on this parameter alpha, and it's just minus 1 over 1 minus alpha. So if you have an alpha of 1/2, your elasticity is just 2. Okay? And the nice thing about these isoelastic demand functions, and I don't want to bother you more with how to derive that. I don't know whether we did it, but in international trade, this Dixit-Stiglitz model is also heavily used, and in IO I also use it. So here, the interesting thing about these isoelastic demand functions is that we can immediately apply the Robinson-Amoroso-Ronzi relation, and we get a very simple markup pricing rule. That is, here the price is just C divided by alpha. We could also put it in terms of the elasticity, but suppose my previous example of alpha is 1/2. That means price is just twice cost. So we have 100% markup here. Okay? very simple markup pricing, and that's why you get a very nice result, because now you can just put up the profit function. This is just a reduced profit. Again, I use the same notation as I previously had. Pi zero means that I have not adopted a new technology, and here the superscript Q of T is just the share, the fraction of rivals which has adopted. Okay, I use the old technology, that's why I have this C bar over here, and so it's a complicated expression. I do not expect you to calculate that here. You should just get the idea. Okay. And so you have these high production costs, and here you have the Q in the denominator, which comes from this price index from your rivals prices. And if Q increases, this the number of consumers, of rivals which have this seed head increases, and that means that your denominator will increase and your profit will go down. Okay, so same effect, the more rivals you have, the lower is your profit given the technology, and that holds also for the case in which you already have implemented a new technology and you have a C hat here. Okay, now what is the nice thing about this model, and why did I have I been able to publish it rather well with the RAND journal? The point is here, you also get diffusion with ex ante identical firms, but they all have the same profit. And I will show you that in a minute. So what is the gain from adoption? The increased profit flow, it's just if I adopt, my profit stream increases from pi 0 to pi 1. However, it depends on Q. And what we will see is that this is decreasing in Q. We get actually the same assumption as Ring-Ganem has. So the point is, if Q is zero, so if the fraction of rivals is zero and I'm the first adopter, my profit gain will be much higher than if Q is one, everyone else has adopted, and I'm the last adopter. Okay, that's what we have here. And now you see, it's now only a one-liner. This profit function, again, you know that already, okay? So there is some date t lower bar, actually it will be equal to the t early we previously had, until no one has adopted a new technology, and I get my profit stream here, given I have not adopted and the share of adopters is zero. At date t lower bar, adoption starts, and I choose adoption date t, so from t lower bar until to t, my profit is pi zero, and it depends on the share of adopters. So if adoption increases over time, my profit always goes down. Okay, that's the important thing. I don't do anything. I just sit around, and still I observe my profit going down. And only that once I adopt, my profit jumps up, because I have new technology, and the diffusion or adoption of all others only end at t upper bar. And from t upper bar, everyone has adopted the new technology. Of course, I have to pay the adoption cost according to my adoption date. And you get a first order condition, which is now very easy, and it's a one-liner. Okay, and here you see my optimal adoption date somehow depends on this share QT. And what we see here is that this first order condition must hold for all T, because if there were some time T where it would not hold, I would have an incentive. If it were greater than zero, I would have an incentive to jump there. And what we get here, if we solve this for QT, and that's what is a nice result here, we get what is called the equilibrium distribution function. Actually, so I don't know whether you are able to understand that in 2 minutes. It took me 2 years, so don't be frustrated if you don't understand it. It took me a long time to come up with this solution. And okay, so that's a hard thing, but once you know it, it's a nicer thing. Okay, now what we learn here, and that's what you could have seen here already, just just substitute here for Q0, then you end up exactly with our adoption date T early we derived in the Rhein-Ganem monopoly model. If you substitute here for Q equal 1, we end up with T late. And so we have determined the adoption dates, or actually the domain on which Q has a value which is different from 0, higher than 0, but is smaller than 1. From all dates T larger than late adoption date, everyone will have adopted. Before the early adoption date, no one will have adopted. And what you see here, and that's, of course, where you have to solve the previous first order condition, is you get this result here. Okay? Well, looks terrible, but it's actually straightforward if you just plot it. Okay? And that's what I did here. So here you have the T, the time of adoption here. And here you have the share of adopters, which is between 0 and 1. And here I depict the different diffusion curves for different degrees of competitiveness. First of all, actually, the first important result is you have different adoption dates among ex-ante identical firms. And each of these firm has the same profit. Okay, that's what is guaranteed by this condition. Okay, d pi dt is 0 over the whole range. That means discounted profit for everyone, for every firm in this industry, is the same. Okay, so we don't face here the Rhein-Ganem problem. And we have a closed form solution, and we can directly derive hypothesis on empirical adoption pattern directly from this function. Okay? And we can also derive, or can look into, some Schumpeterian topics. So how does the intensity of competition affect these diffusion curves? And that's what I'm doing here. You remember the alpha was a very important parameter. So alpha equal to 1/2 meant that the elasticity of demand, which is the same as the elasticity of substitution in this model here, is just 2. Okay? If alpha were to approach 0, we were actually back into the monopoly, because elasticity of demand would be 1. And if alpha is equal to 1, we would have a homogeneous product, and we would be back to perfect competition. And so what we see here is, if we have a low intensity of competition, we get a rather late diffusion of the new technology, and most firms adopt not at the same time, but at a rather similar times. If we increase intensity of competition, going from 0.3 to 0.5, this speeds up the diffusion curve, and it also expands it a little bit. This also holds still for 0.7, but at 0.9, you see a very interesting thing. With 0.9, the intensity of competition is very, very high. The elasticity of demand is very high. Calculate it here. You should produce something like 1.1 or something like not 0.1 actually. Well, just calculated elasticity is minus 1 over 1 minus 0.9. Oh, it would be 10. Okay. It would be 10. Oh, the minus, we have to get rid of the 10. So it would be 10. What does this mean? It just means that if you adopt the new technology, you attract really large demand from your rivals. Okay, and that means the gain from being first is very high. So you're willing to accept a very high adoption cost. But the problem is, if you're already 3 or 4 or 5 adopters, your gain will be rather low. And if you catch up, it doesn't get back you so much, and that's why we get this kind of extended diffusion curve. Okay, that's what you see here. So the reason for this pattern here is that you have two opposite effects of an increase in the elasticity of demand. The high elasticity gives the opportunity to attract huge demand if prices are low, if you lower the prices. But the point is, remember that the alpha was also related to the markup, but actually the price was equal to C over alpha. And if alpha is close to one, you earn a very low markup, your profit is very small, so the return from adoption will also be small. Okay? Yeah, and finally, what I wanted to show you, remember I showed you this very strange diagrams from or empirical studies from Mansfield, showing that different industries have very or feature very different diffusion curves, and one there is a diffusion curve which is almost vertical, and there are diffusion curves where you see diffusion takes very, very long. Now, what you see from my model or what my model shows is that this might be due to different intensities of competition, a different degree of competitiveness. Okay? That's pretty much it. Yeah, so that was actually what was published in the RAND. Then I did some more research on that, and as in the real world, firms are heterogeneous. I also introduced some heterogeneity just by introducing just a parameter B. Just think of Opel and BMW, same prices. People might consider BMW more of higher quality than Opel, and therefore demand, given the prices, would be higher. Okay, and if you introduce heterogeneity, you will see that larger firms will adopt earlier than smaller ones. That's what we saw in our rank effects discussion. And diffusion will start earlier and take longer in a model with these heterogeneous firms than in the basic model. And what is interesting, we always get a relation between firm size and adoption cost. But this holds only if adoption costs are not dependent on firm size. Okay? If they increase linearly with firm size, the adoption costs, this relation would vanish. Okay? I think, I don't know whether we have a diagram or a problem or in the problem set here, but anyway. So what I want to show you, and that's why I was so proud of this result, is what you see, hopefully you recognize it, this is an S-shaped curve. Okay, this is an S-shaped curve where I didn't put an S-shape in. I have heterogeneity here, but heterogeneity is just uniformly distributed, okay, by this value, which gives you some difference between the firms. If you, for instance, assume that Z is equal to 6 over 5, that is 1.2, the largest firm will be 11 times the smallest firms in terms of size, and you just have a uniform distribution of all that. Okay? Yeah. You still might ask why this is interesting. That's why I want to show you this diagram, which is taken from a paper from my colleague Christine Zulehner. And this shows DRAMs. These are dynamic random access memory. These are just semiconductors. These are just computer chips. Okay. And what you see here are the diffusion curves for the different generations. So 4K, you might not remember that. 64, I don't know whether your random access memory has probably 1 gigabyte or much more. But here you see the diffusion curves. Okay, we have diffusion curve. Actually, that's not a diffusion curve, but this is the same thing. This is just the number of the new adoptions, which is the same thing as what we had in terms of as what we had in terms of our photovoltaic data, of our solar panel data. If I'm able to find them, this was pretty much just the number of new installations. Okay, this is what we get in terms of our not of our diffusion curves, but the new installations. That's the same thing here. Okay, and what you see is two features which I want to highlight. You have overlap. For instance, here I think this is 64K, this dotted line, and 64K starts here with the adoption in 82, even though some people still adopt 16K. Okay, and that goes on for a long time. And what you also see, many more people adopt 64K than 16K, and many more people adopt, I don't know what this is here, probably it's 4 megabyte, than adopted 2 megabyte. Okay, so what you have is two things. First of all, we have an overlap, and second of all, we have what we might call leapfrogging. Not every user adopts each generation. Okay, if you have a computer based on 64K, you might just skip the generation with 256K and jump here to the generation with 1 megabyte. Okay, and what I wanted, or what I do, is based on this model with the heterogeneous consumers, and apart from that, I just use my standard monopolistic competitive setup. I can produce a version where we have this overlap. Okay, this is just taken from a model with two generations, where Z is equal to 3/2, and the largest firm is 5 times the smallest firms. And I am running out of time in this respect here. And I also can produce leapfrogging. Okay, and what you see here the number of the first generation, the area below the first generation is much lower than the area below the second generation here. That is, more people, more use, more firms adopt the second generation than the first generation. And here in this range, you have overlap, and here in this range you have the leapfroggers who adopted a new technology but not the old one. Okay, unfortunately I never got published this paper. It's still a working paper and awaits some further calculations. I have several hundred pages of Mathematica output, and I still was not able to finish this paper. The point was, actually, this version is from 2006, and 2007 I started my professorship in Gießen, and that cost me so much time that I had to abandon that. But if you're interested in doing a PhD thesis on these topics, you're welcome to join me and to work on this topic further on. So what you could do, of course, is to derive some further empirical hypothesis on that topic. And I think I did that with Thomas Sebro, which is now at HEC in Paris, but we didn't manage to publish it. But hopefully at some future time we manage it. Okay, that's just the diffusion curves then. There is one final topic. And this topic, hopefully I can do it in the remaining 5 minutes. It relates to this problem of Jennifer Wayne Ganem, that in the duopoly the profits are not equalized of the two firms. Okay, and we have in this case a preemption equilibrium. I just want to illustrate now in a minute, and it's rather straightforward. Okay, if you have Bertrand competition and a homogeneous product, and you have adoption of the process innovation, k lower bar, it's just the arrow model here, okay? You know that, and assume you have inelastic demand, and you have undiscounted adoption cost xt with x prime t, and the gain from adopting the new technology, if only one firm adopts, is simply here, actually, our rectangle, our green rectangle, if you remember that, okay? Because our q was 1, okay, and it's just the green rectangle we have here. Of course, now we have in continuous time and until infinity, that's why we divide by r. So this is just our v. And what you will see in equilibrium, V is, has just to be equal to 2x. What does it mean? Only one firm innovates and we get complete rent dissipation. Why is that so? I will illustrate that in a second by means of a diagram here. Now, the social optimum, however, would be rather different here, because now we have to take into account that we also have to discount this cost. We have to discount here the adoption date, and only then the V accrues. And you will see that we get then a first order condition. So I just take the time derivative here, and this is the first order condition. Okay, taking first derivative with respect to the second part here, you get this here, and then taking the further derivative with respect to this minus x here, and you get this part. And what you see is that the social optimal solution means that adoption takes place too soon, and we have rent dissipation, which is socially wasteful. Okay, I just want to illustrate it here. Suppose here we have an undiscounted gain from adoption, and we have adoption cost here V. Just our V would be just our K minus or K minus K lower bar divided by R. And what you see here is, just suppose one firm would adopt here. It would earn a certain profit like this. What would the other firm do? Actually, it would just jump here and would earn then this profit. However, you would get these in a sense, like in the undercutting in the Bertrand model, you would always get that the other firm then adopts earlier. Suppose you will wait until 15, then the other just adopts at 14. And in the end, it only ends here if you're going here. The only adoption date, which then means that V is equal to X here, would be this T equal 5. This is not really convincing. That's why I produced here the same thing with discounted gains from adoption. And then it looks like this here. And here you see the optimal value is where you have the same slope of the adoption cost function and this V function. This would be the socially optimal adoption date. But of course, if you were to choose that, you would get this profit, but the other firm would get nothing. So the other firm would just, what is called here, preempt you. Okay, and it only ends here. And of course, this is wasteful. Why? Yeah, because we have this arrow set up. If some firm introduces an innovation, reduction, okay, the price is just unchanged and we get this limit price result. So it's socially wasteful because consumer don't gain, but the firm invests too much, it has too high adoption cost. And here you just see what the preemption date is and what the socially optimal adoption date would be, given these functions here, V raised to the V times E minus raised to the power of minus RT and so on. Okay? That was our preemption equilibrium. There is, however, a very interesting second one. I'm running out of time, so I would ask you for another 5 minutes here. I'm telling you something about shopping hours right now. Okay? I don't know, you are probably all too young, but until, say, 10 or 15 years ago, shopping hours were limited in the sense that you could open your shop not longer than 6 p.m. in the afternoon. Okay, then the question is then, what do you think about the profit of a firm if, like Rewe, if it extends its shopping hour? And if Edeka also extends its shopping hour? Actually, pretty much it might be unchanged. Okay, because if both, do people buy more if there are longer shopping hours? Will you buy more groceries, more things to eat if you have time until, say, 8 or 10 rather than till 6? Will you eat more? Probably not. So in a sense, what we have here is just a redistribution of profits, and that's what I want to highlight you with these profits. Suppose in a beginning both firms having not adopted longer shopping hours, so closing at 6 p.m., have some profit, okay, greater than one. Then if only one firm adopts the new technology, that is, in our case, if Rewe extended shopping hours, but Edeka doesn't, what happens? We get some Rewe gets some more profit, and it's exactly equal to what Edeka loses, okay? It's just a redistribution of profits. It's just a zero-sum game, okay? And if both adopt, profits will be literally unchanged. However, of course, you have adoption costs. So from a viewpoint of a joint profit maximization, what would be optimal? Never increase or never go for longer shopping hours, okay? And that's what we are going to look into right now. Actually, empirically, it's not so easy, of course, because you have large firms, you have small firms, and so on. And I could tell you some more about that and about my parents' corner shop and so on. But anyway, I want to leave it like this here in terms of our motivation. And I just want to explain the equilibrium. We need some function or some assumption here on the adoption costs. You will see later on that it's important here to have this assumption. Otherwise, if we don't make this assumption, we just don't have an interesting problem. And there are two Nash equilibria here. Nash equilibria one is that Edeka expects Rewe to increase its shopping hour. So what is the optimal thing for Edeka? To also increase its shopping hour, and if Edeka increases its shopping hour, Rewe will do so as well. So this would be the immediate joint adoption model. There's, however, another one in which adoption never takes place. So if Edeka, if Rewe knows that Edeka waits and doesn't adopt the new shopping hour, the higher shopping hour, it knows that if it will extend its shopping hours, Edeka will follow suit in the next period. And on the next slide, I'm just showing you the payoffs and showing you why these two equilibria exist. Okay, and what from the viewpoint of joint profit maximization, Nash equilibrium one with immediate joint adoption is the Pareto inferior one. Okay, and Tyrol, from which I took this example, showed that you might interpret the delayed introduction of compact cars by US car industry in this way. Okay, they just thought if we all introduce that, our profits stay pretty much the same, but our costs increase. So we waited until the 70s and then the Japanese came and took over this market, but that's another story. Okay, the final point, and I think I have two slides left here. How does the equilibrium with simultaneous adoption in period one look like? So this immediate, quick imitation and immediate adoption. Suppose the rival adopts in period one. You expect, you are Rewe, you expect Edeka to adopt in period one. If you also adopt in period one, what is your profit? Actually, your profit is unchanged by example, because you have profit pi 1, 1, which is equal by definition to pi 0, 0. You have longer shopping hours now, but no one or you don't get any higher sales. Okay, the only thing is, so you get now for all times in each period, you discount this your profit stream, which is pi 0, 0, but you have to pay the adoption costs, or in the case of shopping hours, you have to pay more to your workers, because now they have to work overtime and so on. And you get that immediately from the you calculate this here, this term immediately from this formula for infinite geometric series. Okay, 1 plus r over r times pi 0, 0 is your profit. Now the question is, what would you get if you do not adopt? The point here is, of course, I put that later. If you do not adopt, you get exactly the same, apart from the fact that you have the minus one here. Okay, and of course, if you have the minus one here, you see that's then this here, you can rearrange that, and you see then, because the pi zero drops out, here this part drops out here, you get that x here, minus x is greater or x is smaller than this expression here on the left-hand side, but that was our assumption above. Okay, the point is, if you expect your rival to adopt, it's optimal for you to also adopt. Okay, and you don't need to look into the case, that's what's in this note here, where you adopt only in the second or third period, because if it's optimal to adopt at all, it's always optimal to adopt immediately, because otherwise you just lose profit. Okay, and now, so the profit of the equilibrium, I already did that. Given firm 2 adopts, it's always optimal for firm 1 also to adopt, and by symmetry, the opposite holds as well. How do we get the equilibrium without adoption? Now, this is pretty much actually the same thing here, because the point is, without adoption, if you expect the rival not to adopt, you get also pi 0, 0 here. And if you never adopt it, and the point is here, and you just don't have to pay. Now, what you have to do, and I think I didn't do that, and you are supposed to do that in the next, in one of the assignments. What is your profit if you adopt? You know in period, and that's probably I should just use a different color right now here. If you adopt in period 1, you get this plus 1, okay? And then from the next period on, you just, because if you adopt in period 1, we saw, or we showed here, actually, that it's always optimal if your rival adopts, you also adopt. So if you adopt in period 0, it's actually, your rival will, if your rival adopts in period 0, Edeka will adopt in period 1. And from then on, it holds. So you just get 1 pi 0, 0 more. And actually, that's what we can hold, or what we showed with the assumptions, is that this is not sufficient. This only profit increase for just a period is not sufficient here by this assumption to account or to make this profitable. Okay, you always know if you adopt in this, if your rival doesn't adopt and you adopt now, your rival will follow suit in the next period. And that's like a little bit in a cartel. You know, if you have a collusive situation, if you deviate now from this collusive situation, we will be punished. Okay. And given our assumptions here, similar to the assumptions we have once we talk about collusion, about the discount factor, given these assumptions, it's always optimal not to adopt. And what we get here is then this equilibrium without adoption. So the question is why we do observe longer shopping hours. Just the fact that it was legally allowed doesn't explain that. And actually, that's what you learned in smaller cities, where you had some equally sized companies. Perhaps they started with long, they experimented with longer shopping hours in the very beginning, but then they all moved back to close earlier, because they saw it's just higher costs without giving them higher profits, because people just don't more eat, because if they can shop more. Hopefully this was somehow clear. Actually, I think I'm done with this part right now. Next week we won't have a lecture, because there is for Leichnam, whatever this is in English, there's a holiday, and but we have covered sufficient ground here already for having now twice the tutorial class without a lecture. I thank you for your participation. I hope that it was halfway clear. And I'm available on WebEx for further questions. And thanks again, and bye.